I helped set up in June, and they had a lot of potatoes. Unfortunately, a lot of them were rotting already, so they had to throw quite a few. They never know what they need for food. They get personal products, cereal, canned goods, some frozen things. Actually got some nice frozen meat, turkey, and I think maybe some chicken this time. But they're able to purchase some, and then they just get whatever they get. But it pretty much goes, and what doesn't go, they'll bring maybe to the food shelf or to some other organization that might be able to use it. But if you're looking for something to do about 4:30, 5 o'clock today, I'm sure they could use help in distribution. That's at the high school, elementary. Well, no.
Senior high.
Senior high. I should get those buildings straight. Yeah.
Pretty rewarding to go help.
In the cafeteria area, yeah.
Is that something we could maybe advertise, like from Blaze for volunteer option?
Oh, we could, yeah. We have signs up down in our shop, but yeah.
But maybe.
Yeah. I mean, some people in our department know about it, but yeah, sure, good.
So we might be able to.
I could get you some information. There's going to be another drop in August as well, so that'll be another.
Buffalo.
I could get you that info, if you like. Any questions, comments about that? Okay, and then the last thing, I just wanted to give you some information. I always like to toot our horn when you can, because we can't always. But the federal government has expectations of every state when it comes to kids in out-of-home placements. And they always review what's going on in the state, what their foster care reentry rate is, what the reunification rate is. And of course, that all rolls down to the counties, because the counties actually do that work. So the federal government looked back to, I think it was 2006, to see what the foster care reentry and reunification activity was in all of the states. And Minnesota did not pass that federal review for that period of time. And they went back and forth, did a PIP, had conversations with the feds. And long story short, they negotiated fine, essentially, to the state, to the tune of about a little over $755,000. And the Department of Human Services decided that they were not going to pay that. They were going to pass that on to the counties, that expense, because it's the counties that did or didn't do the work as far as the reunification and the foster care reentry. Well, as it turns out, there were four counties in the state that did not were not assigned a fee, because our reentry rates and our reunification rates were where they were supposed to be, and we were one of those counties that was not assessed a fine, if you will, because our work wasn't the way it was supposed to be. So I think that's great news. It's, you know, when there's only four out of 87 counties that did not have a fine, and of course the larger counties were the brunt. But I was pretty pleased when I saw the minus sign or nothing in our in the column for Stevens County. So
but they didn't give you a bonus.
No.
Right.
No. We never expect that. It's just we're happy when we don't have
right.
to pay. But I wanted to share that information. I think it certainly speaks to the quality of the work that my staff do. And, you know, there's a lot of moving parts in our work, and we have to pay attention to a lot of different things at the same time. So when everything kind of comes together and works the way we want it to, I always like it when we can acknowledge the work of the staff. I want to let you guys know that sometimes it works out well.
Congratulate them, of course.
Yeah, I would do that.
Absolutely.
Yep. So that's all I have today.
Okay.
Unless you have something else for me.
Thank you.
Okay.
Thanks, Tony.
Have a good day.
And I'd like to apologize. Our camera didn't work to start the meeting. Didn't miss too much. She's got it running now, so we'll take Amanda.
Good morning.
Morning.
Were there any questions on the auditor's report? That you guys did get.
Yep, we did. Yeah.
Okay.
questions?
On the auditor?
Yeah. Can move on, I guess, to Commissioner Warren.
If there are no questions, they just need approval.
I'll second it.
Got a motion and a second to approve the Commissioner's warrants. Any further discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign. Approve the Commissioner's warrants.
Becky asked, and I agree with her, the Office of the State Auditors sent us an engagement letter to sign. It is unusual in the fact that it's a three-year engagement letter. Also, I looked in the past 2 years when we indeed have signed one. It has normally been signed in March or February of the year where the audit is actually taking place. So it's signed February of 15 when the 14 audit is being done. That's not the case with this one.
Didn't we already sign one?
We signed them on an annual basis.
Right, but we already signed an engagement letter for 14.
For 14, yeah. And the audit is almost done. This one is for fiscal year 15, 16, and 17, which is, like I said, unusual since it is for 3 years. And Becky got an email from the Association of Minnesota Counties, am I correct?
Yep.
And we are not the only county that has received a three-year engagement letter. The association is trying to communicate with the OSA to inquire as to what the reasoning is for a three-year as opposed to a one-year. We're pretty certain that it's due to the legislation option.
I think that now that we have the option, we should go out and get a quote,
right,
because I know what that would be. And their revenue, their budget is funded by receipts. So the audit funds their budget for the next fiscal year. So I think they're probably trying, I'm speculating here, but I'm speculating they're trying to plan their budget for the next three fiscal years.
And the law goes into effect in 16, doesn't it?
Yes.
That we can choose, right, or we get up.
Yeah.
Yeah, so.
And based on Becky's request, I did go ahead and request a quote from Clifton Allen Larson. They have been auditing counties since the OSA has allowed it. So they are a very senior group in auditing counties. They have locations in as close to Alexandria, so their travel costs would be minimal. And so I did request one to get here by the middle of August so we can discuss that in August. So we can go ahead and take a look at that and see. There is no fee schedule included with the current engagement letter either from the OSA, which I do want to receive from them.
But won't we have to have a deal with the state to do 15?
Yes.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
So we'll have to get a letter signed for that eventually.
Right. But like Becky said, we don't necessarily want to do a 3-year.
No, I agree.
That's
but
the case.
Yeah. So then they'll send us a 1-year.
Yeah, so Amanda will have to go back to him and just do an engagement letter for 1 year, and then we'll go forward. She's, you know, I told her at this time, let's just get one quote and just see what the market is for comparison. And, you know, I would anticipate that Office of State Auditor maybe will get a little bit more competitive as well in their rates.
Yeah.
You know, they haven't, they've monopolized roughly 70 counties, you know, with auditing, and they've done a great job. We've had a great working relationship with them. They've got good advice and good guidance on issues. So it's not that we want to leave there, but we also want to be prudent with the taxpayer dollars too, to make sure that, you know, we're getting the best deal out there.
And I looked at past history in the audit expense since 2012 has started, it has been decreasing, especially since we went, we actually have a marshal field office that is taking care of us and not the Morehead, so it has been reducing, so I think that's probably going to be the trend. But like Becky said, I think it's important to go ahead and see what else is out there. And then I'll communicate, based on that, Becky and I will communicate them and just try and see if we can't get a one-year engagement letter with the Office of State Auditors for 15's audit. So that was just an update. Was there any questions on that?
That'll still be with the Marshall Office, though.
That'll still be with the Marshall Office, yes. And they're very good about keeping the same group that come here, so they've dealt with us, they kind of know who to contact. So it makes life a little bit easier, and Melody will lead there. She is really great to work with as far as she'll request things ahead of time, so they can just be here for a day or two at a time. And so we can do a lot of things, electronic communication too, that helps with our expenses. If there are no more questions on that. If you recall, last time I informed that we only have one forfeiture on the books. And spoke to the city of Hancock. It's a very narrow parcel. It's 40 feet by 120 feet. And based on the city of Hancock's building regulations, this parcel will not be able to have a building built on it. It needs to be 50 feet from the right-of-way, 15 feet from the property line to the building structure on the front side of the road. It needs to be 10 feet in from the rear side, meaning that you're going to have a structure of a whopping 5 feet wide. So it's not a parcel that we will be able to sell at all unless somebody wants to sit on a lawn chair. So I looked into what are other options that we have, and we do have the option to sell it to adjacent owners for as little as a dollar, just to put it back on the tax rolls and make sure that it's being taken care of. Because as of right now, it is a vacant land, so there are no safety issues that we have to be concerned with. But at the same time, we don't need weeds growing, and we want to make sure that it's being taken care of. So we have that option of the private sale to the adjacent landowners. However, it does require the approval of the city, so I would have to go to the city of Hancock and ask that the county be able to sell it as a private sale to the adjacent landowners. I think this is the best option because there aren't going to be any options for somebody who's not an adjacent landowner to build on it. If we do have the adjacent landowner, they have the option because the parcel therefore becomes larger. I'm not saying that it becomes the same parcel, but because they own both of them, they have special, they don't have to follow the parcel lines for the structure. If they want to build a garage on it with their parcel,
they could get a variance from the city.
Yes. And somebody who just purchased it, it was probably a location for an old trailer, and that's not going to probably be an option here.
So you contacted the adjacent landowner? Is anybody interested?
Nobody's really interested, and I couldn't necessarily give them a price without speaking to you and the city. Like I said, we can sell it for as low as a dollar, but that's your guys' decision. That's not mine. So I wanted to speak to you guys before I said anything in particular. In order to transfer the title, it's going to cost around $100. There's the $46 reporting fee, there's the state deed tax, there's the deed recording. So it is going to cost the taxpayer, if we do charge them that, to put it back on the tax rolls. It's not a money maker parcel. It basically is in our best interest to put it back on the tax rolls, and the taxpayer would really be doing us the favor. So my recommendation is to sell it for a dollar because we have to sell it for something. And then I would say, since they are helping us out to pay the recording fee and such out of the tax forfeiture property fund.
Who owns it now?
To be honest with you, I don't know who owns it.
It is kept up.
I know that.
So somebody does, but I don't know who that is.
Need a motion to have it move ahead?
I will need to speak to the city in order to make this, but...
Or do you just need permission to go ahead and get things lined up?
I need permission to go ahead and to sell it for as little as a dollar. And so I can confirm that with the city so everyone understands the expenses, that who will be paying what, so... But I need permission also to spend it out of the tax forfeiture fund.
I would think we should get enough to cover our expenses on it myself, but...
It's been on the, it's been tax forfeited since 2003, so I can't... So...
Eventually we'll get our fees back and taxes, but it'll take, it's not taxed very heavily yet.
No, it's not, but it'll take a while to get it back on taxes. But I think the sooner we get it back there, the better, and the most, the more appealing we can make it, the better.
And there's only one possible person that would take it? There's their houses on each side of it?
There, it's actually on a corner lot. So there's actually only two parcels that are attached to it. So there's really only two people that would be interested in that particular parcel. And of course, they have been notified of the forfeiture sales in the past and haven't shown any interest. So I think as appealing as we can make it, I think we'd be most better.
So if you, we offered to sell it for a dollar and either one of them still want it?
They were stuck with it.
They were stuck with it.
Any discussion, any motions, any...
But Phil, at least we can say we tried.
Yeah, obviously.
You could give Amanda some flexibility and say, you know, we can try to get expenses for it, but as little as, maybe would be a thought, but it's up to you. I mean, certainly we talked about that, trying to get those recovered for the sale.
Yes.
For the recording fees and stuff.
Well, historically, the last time we tried, we set a limit, didn't we? As I recall.
It was 500.
500, and then...
Was the minimum.
Was the minimum, so...
Normal minimum, so...
Say, yeah.
So you could say for no less than?
Try to get our money back, because no one's ever offered it to them for $150 for a lot, at a bad price. And then if they don't take it, go down to a dollar and say we're... Yes.
Second.
Got a motion and a second to try to sell the forfeiture property in Hancock for no less than $150. That'll cover expenses, though. I know more than $150, I'm sorry. Any further discussion?
Well, yeah, now you just made that public, so why would anybody pay $150 when they pay a dollar?
I wasn't gonna put the dollar in there.
Well, anyway, let's...
The motion is up to $150.
Up to $150. Any further discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, same sign. Motion passes.
And I spoke, one last thing is the Hancock has started the process of giving us back the old Owl's Nest building, so that deed is in process to be remitted back to the state, and then it will be in care of it again. Becky has looked into options that we have to demolition, and I'm speaking with some other auditor members to see what they have done in the past as far as recouping those demolition costs. If they've budgeted for it, if they've taken out of their tax forfeiture fund, some of them have passed some of it on to purchaser or to developing, and depending upon if we do it a loan or a grant, will be depending upon how much it'll actually cost. So that's still a work in progress as of right now.
We can talk about that really quick right now. I was giving you guys an update. There's two different deed grants. One's a contamination cleanup grant, and that would involve demolition and identification of contaminants and then demolition. And one is a redevelopment grant. And I contacted the Hancock EDA about a potential, and I know it's very difficult to look at a property like that and think there's a potential for redevelopment, but there really is a limited amount. I mean, there's open space downtown, but there's really a limited, you take that out, you're taking out a lot of square footage in the downtown. So, and I think potentially if you went into it with the option of a redevelopment grant, you'd probably get a better chance of getting funding from DEED. And they rarely give out, they have certain percentage of those funds have to be spent in outstate Minnesota, and they don't have a lot of competition for those funds. The contamination cleanup grant is August 1st. I can't get it filed by then. The next round would be early next year. The redevelopment grant, the second round of funding for this go-round is November 1st, and we could potentially get something put together by then. But I would want to work with the city of Hancock and the EDA there, because they're going to have to be a partner in it. And so I think both of those are going to ask for board commitment. But, you know, looking at what some of the demolition costs were, if we would get set, it's a 75-25% match on most of the funding. And they're going to need a sponsorship by the county board if we go after one of those two, guaranteeing that 25% is going to be paid. But, you know, we were willing to spend some money before on demolition and partner with Hancock. So I'm just kind of asking you to start thinking about it, if we could get them to partner with us and not exceed that 25% of the total of what we were willing to spend before. I think there's a good chance we could get some funding for it. And it certainly is better than sitting empty. Right now it's, you know, an imminent public health threat with some of the building structure being compromised, and then there's some interior contamination and stuff like that from animals and other things. So I guess start thinking about that. I've already made contact with the EDA there, but we really can't proceed with it until it's transferred back to the state, and then we are custodians of it. So we have to wait until that process is through, and then we can start working on the grant application. So any questions there?
Either we're going to get brunt, or we're going to get the full 100% of the expense to tear that down.
Exactly.
So the 25% is a good deal for us.
Yeah. Okay. Good. You're right. We have insurance right now. We've got maintenance of it, and we have to go back over and resecure the premises. I think it's been opened up and stuff since we transferred it back over to them. So we have all that. We've got the insurance expense. Like Ron pointed out, we'll have 100% of demolition if we don't do something. And I know we were sitting at our economic development meeting the other week, and we lose 100% of them. Well, somebody made a comment, we lose 100% of the money we don't go after. And this is money you could bring into the community. So it's just going to probably take some creative thinking and trying to go after some of these funds. So. Okay.
All right.
Thank you.
We're going to Cohen White, the drug court coordinator.
Do you mind going in and bring a second chair up?
No, I was going to say, you have her join you, introduce her. Thank you for being here.
Thank you for allowing me the opportunity to come before you today and talk to you about a project that has been going on in the 8th Judicial District, and specifically in Stevens County, for the last year. We've been up and running. I have brought Courtney W. We referred everybody by their first names in the drug court. With me today, she is our first participant that entered drug court a year ago, and is going to, knock on wood at this point, when all goes well, be our first graduate here in the next couple months. So. I'm just going to give you a brief update about what drug court is and where that is for me, and then I'd just like Courtney to have a few minutes to speak to you from her personal experience going through this in the last year. So, technology, let's see how we're doing. So I'm not sure how familiar anybody on the county board right now is familiar with drug court itself, but drug court is a specialized court process. It's been around since 1989 nationally, and been around in Minnesota since the early 2000s. Hennepin County started their district drug court in, the spring of 2000, and it's been around ever since nationally. It's a growing trend, and legislation in the last years have been really pushing forward with the positive results that they want drug court expanded throughout the entire state of Minnesota. Oops. So drug court provides intensive treatment for those individuals who are highly chemically dependent, as well as involved in our criminal justice system. So you need someone who is on felony, has a felony charge and/or conviction, and who's also deemed chemically dependent, moderate, or severe by Rule 25, which is our assessing body. And they are held very accountable by drug court for meeting their obligations, not only to the court, but to society as a whole. We do regular and random drug testing. There's a drug testing line that they call every day, and so they have to report whatever their color is, whenever their color is called, and they have specific guidelines in order to do that. We have, here in Stevens County, we have drug court every 2 weeks, so every other Thursday they appear in front of Judge Seibel, and they have been doing so for a year. Judge Glazer is our backup judge and will become our primary judge upon Judge Seibel's retirement. And we've all been trained in the drug court national drug court standards, so we do this according to national rules. We don't make this up as we go. If you look at drug court versus the standard court procedure, in the due process procedure, which is the standard criminal justice system, we talk about the event. We talk about you committed this crime. Where in drug court, we talk about the process. It's like, what got you here? For people like Courtney and the others involved in drug court, their criminal activity was primarily based around their drug use. So they were selling drugs, doing drugs, committing burglaries to get money for drugs. It was all, it's all a process. And again, when we're looking at a very specific event, we're looking at more behavior specific events in a drug court process. Again, the difference of determination of guilt, and again, we look more at the addiction in the drug court process. It's much more offender centered. We have a drug court team made up of the prosecution, defense, the judge, myself, probation, treatment. Thank you, my voice is, I've been having some voice problems. I'm gonna get that fixed. And so we all meet as a team every 2 weeks, and we staff every participant in drug court. And we, so a lot of times people that are involved in the criminal justice system can be quite gamey, for lack of a better term, and we often find triangulation where they're talking treatment, one person saying one thing to treatment, one thing to probation, one thing to the court, and this allows that to be totally disseminated because we are all there together every 2 weeks. It's a very much different process where the judge doesn't interact with the attorneys, they interact specifically with the individuals. Judge Seibel personally talks to every one of our participants every 2 weeks. And we, our responsibility is to look at the behavior change. So from a traditional probation perspective, we, which is where my background and my history is for those of you who know me, these are the rules, you follow the rules. And although we expect that, we also want to talk about why these are difficulties for you, what's more going on in your life. So, and so we reinforce a treatment perspective. Although, again, the criminal justice system is over 400 years old, and this process is only 25 years old, we've really been very pleasantly surprised with the change. So again, who qualifies? There's a process. Currently, the 8th Judicial District operates one drug court, but we have three assignment areas made up of multiple counties in each assignment area, and I coordinate all three of those assignment areas. They need to be a felony level offense, and they need to have a substance use disorder, so someone qualified to do Rule 25 assessments. Again, we can deal with, we find oftentimes a lot of our participants have co-occurring disorders, mental health diagnosis, and that we can help with that as well. So they cannot be an active gang member. And we also allow the county attorney's office to be the gatekeeper, so to speak. So they look at the criminal offense, they get the input, and they have to allow the go-ahead in order to get into drug court. These are the representatives. When I talk about other adjunct members, we will bring in people that have child welfare, their case manager for that, and other members that play active roles in the participant's life from a professional perspective. So the goals of drug court are to ensure participants' accountability. Again, that's due intensive supervision, drug testing, frequent visits with the court, and again, we're all aware of what the conditions are. Reduce costs to society. I'm sure that this is something that you guys are more interested in, what's this costing us or saving us in this particular case. Statistically, and I will give you the stats for the judicial district, drug court participants spend less time incarcerated. Again, we'll see that in our, in some slides coming up specifically to the judicial district. We have a lot of potential to avoid out-of-home placements. I think Courtney has some children that were pretty close to being on her home, that were out of her home, and she is now has them all back, and she's very happy to do that. All our participants are required to have employment. Again, a lot of times people with felony level convictions find it difficult to find employment, and we can work with potential employers in that. And then they're contributing back, obviously, by paying taxes. The national standard is for every dollar spent, there's a $2.21 benefit to the communities for drug court participants. And then the national Minnesota drug courts did an evaluation down in 2012. They just did an update that came out this spring. I don't have the stats for that yet, but at that time there was over $3,000 less spent for every drug court participants. Nationally, and I have to use national statistics and state statistics right now just because we're only a year old, so, but we again are seeing some really positive trends in our local drug court. Again, just some statistical data. On average, again, people are, there more people are employed, they get their high school diplomas, they have stable housing, they have valid driver's license, and they're paying their child support. So, participating counties currently in the 8th Judicial District, as you can see, there are Grant, Traverse, Stevens, Swift, Chippewa, Kanawha County, and Meeker. This northern assignment area, which is included in Stevens County, also includes Grant and Traverse, and we have participants either in programming or about to start programming in both of those counties as well, and they come to Morris here and meet with the judge every week. So I was looking at this from the last year, because again, we're brand new, and we had 642 felony filed complaints filed in the 7 participating counties last year. My goal at, when I first started, became involved in this program, I thought about 10%. We'd have 10% of our participants. Again, not knowing where we were at or what we were doing. So we had 58 referrals to the district for drug court, and you can see how they came in pretty statistically half and half, males and females. We had no denials here at the county attorney's level in Stevens, Grant, or Travers counties in the northern assignment area. So anybody that was referred to drug court to the county attorney's office was permitted entrance. Again, some of the denials, so once they go through the county attorney's office, they come to my office and I do a second screening, and there are some reasons that they can't get in. Residency, of course, we have to be able to supervise these people. They might not be high risk, high needs. We don't currently allow those individuals that have felony DWIs. Statistically, you have to have a separate track, because those individuals that are addicted to alcohol have a different, just a different set of circumstances than individuals. We do plan on morphing into having a DWI compatible track. However, the DCI, the Drug Court Initiative at the state level, says we have to be functional 2 years or more before we can add that. So we're working towards that. Of course, we can't force people, so if they're not following through the screening, they can't get in. And then we had some other issues, but they can. It's a voluntary program, and we did have 4 individuals voluntarily withdraw from drug court, and again, you can see they're kind of all over the board. And these statistics are about a month old, and as with human behavior, those things change by the moment. So we've only had 4 people terminated, one of them from Stevens County, and I have the stats specifically for Stevens County. As of July 1st, we had 16 participants throughout the district, and that's how they got in. And Crystal, right there, you can see we have 4 phases prior to graduation, and the one individual in phase 4 is sitting next to me right now, and so she's going to talk about that. Some of the highlights overall, is that before acceptance into drug court, those active participants, those 16 active participants, served a total of 544 days in jail. Since being accepted into drug court, they've only served 36. Now again, those stats are skewed a little bit. We had did have a participant relapse shortly after this in the central assignment area, but we are have been back on track and back in programming. So, and we've only had one new felony level offense, which I think out of all those 58 participants that we've had coming through in the 16 current is pretty remarkable. We have, the majority of our employee participants are working, and then we had one person regain a valid driver's license and insurance. So again, very proud of the work that Courtney has done in this program. So Stevens County currently has 4 active participants. We have I just received a new referral today, so we're hoping to add our 5th participant. Statistically, we are receiving our supervision services from the Traverse County Probation Office, which also covers Stevens County and has historically for years. And they are going to currently cap us at about 8 participants. That's what they can kind of handle right now and provide the adequate supervision. So we are getting close to getting full. We've been conscious about growing slowly and making sure we're taking the right people in because, again, we want this program to be successful. We were new at it. The people who we were dealing with, it didn't need us to be continually screwed up. So we're going slow and making, trying to make really smart decisions. We have a minimum of 157 days sober. Again, for most of these participants, this is the longest period they've ever been sober. For most participants, this is the longest they've ever been being fully employed. So again, we're really proud of where they've come and the work they've done. So in Stevens County, in the last from July 1st last year till May 30th of this year, we've had 53 felony complaints filed. Out of those 53, nine referrals were made to drug court. We've had 2 denied based on criteria. Again, they either weren't high risk or high needs. They weren't either chemically dependent or their criminal record did not show that they would be continually committing crimes. What we don't want to do is put people in the program that don't need that level of supervision. We had, again, someone failed to follow through with their paperwork, one voluntary withdrawal, and that person is now serving their prison time. And then one person terminated, also serving their prison time, and then the currently 4 active participants. So drug court works, it reduces crime, it saves money. Again, statistically, this is borne itself out year after year after year. And so so we just hope to keep working on that. And I just would like Courtney to just take a few minutes. I breezed through that So the Courtney can tell her story. I think it's always nice so you can hear the human side of, I can give you all the stats in the world, but.
Okay. All right, I'm Courtney, I'm with you. Drug addiction goes back to me when I was about 13 years old. I was raised as a pastor's daughter, so I was raised very good. I kind of just strayed away from that, got in the wrong crowd. Did not know how to handle my emotions, so I went to drugs. Over the years, I moved to Minnesota, so the last 5 years of my life were complete hell, crazy. I was using meth. I was selling meth, I was manufacturing meth. In the process of all that, I have 3 children. My son is 5. I have a 2-year-old and I have 1-year-old. My daughter was taken out of my home because she was a boy. She was born to meth and family. I went through treatment, I went through jail. And it did not seem to do anything because a year later, I got pregnant and had my other daughter. She was also born to methamphetamine. I went through treatment and I went through jail. I came back home. I went right back to jail. Then drug court popped in and gave me the opportunity of a more structured, more supportive area. I did my treatment. I did everything they needed me to do. if I wouldn't have the support of drug court and the curfews and the UAs and knowing I can call anyone on that team and talk to them about anything, and the judge knowing every detail that I wouldn't know, really helped, because he can talk to me about it. He can also give me, the rest of the team has support, and they give me feedback, like it's not so, I don't feel like everyone is putting me down all the time, they're there to help. Let's see, in the last year, I have gotten so much accomplished. I have my kids back, I have full custody of both my children, I have my own home, I have a manager, Pizza Ranch. I'm getting married next month. and I have myself back. Sorry for the emotion, I don't know where that came from. But, and I know it's a short period of time, but my story goes really far back, and it starts with a lot of stuff. I'm adopted. And when I moved to Minnesota, I moved here from North Carolina and met my birth family. And they were not, it wasn't what I expected, so I turned to drugs and I hit hard. And I probably been arrested more than 18 times. And I went right back to the same thing every time. I've been on probation for the last 5 years before I entered drug court. So nothing. I didn't feel like I had the support I do now.
And how much money do you think you spent on drugs and meds while you were using?
Okay, so in treatment, we did this thing, and I figured out about $2 million was being used or sold from me in 1 year. That's just 1 year. I was manufacturing it as well, so the cost of that and what I was doing to just people in society, why I was bringing people down. Things I was doing was not very pleasant.
And as you sit here today, how many days of sobriety do you have?
I'm going on 2 years. So,
573 years, something like that. We recognize that every time in drug court, because again, for some of these people, this is the longest they've ever been sober.
Mm-hmm.
So, I think Courtney's kind of a walking testimony to the success of the 8th Judicial District Drug Court, specifically here in Stevens County, and I wanted her to have an opportunity to just put a face in front of a name to that today. And I'm sure she'd be willing to answer any questions,
because
she says she does better with questions. So with that, we just want to thank you for your time, and well, if you have any questions, we're willing to answer them. But I just want to thank you for your ongoing support of the 8th Judicial District Drug Court, and we hope to have our graduation, and we'll invite everybody. We're going to really try to celebrate that here at the end of this year.
Thank you for coming.
Thank you for congratulations.
Yes, you should be very, very pleased with yourself. Great job.
Thank you. I've had the honor of being on this team. It's so cool to watch the progress that you've all made. So what's your plan going forward?
Getting married?
Yeah. She's going to be a NARP. Normal, ordinary, responsible person.
All right, I like it.
That's what we call NARPs. So, yeah. You're all invited. I think the one thing I hear time and time again from people watching drug court is it is such a different process. It is such not what they expected. But it's effective and it works. And I guess we've been doing criminal justice the same way for 400 years, and you know, drug addiction hasn't gone down, crime really hasn't gone down. And so if we can, you know, make some people's lives better and make society better as a whole, then we're doing the right thing.
Well, anything we can do to help support it, be sure and come to us.
Right.
Congratulations again.
Thank you.
Thank you very much for your time. Have a great day.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you.
My stuff is kind of boring after
yeah.
that. That's good.
And long always.
The first thing I wanted to talk to you about is the laptops. Charlie did some research for me. We did send some quotes out locally.
Mm-hmm.
We have three different prices we'll present today for you. And again, I just want to preface this by saying that it really is important that you have a piece of county property to do county business on. It's data privacy and protection is what's driving this request. So, you know, if we want to do this immediately, we want to phase them in. If we want to do it in 16, doesn't matter to me really, but I would like to do it sooner rather than later. And Charlie can help. We can do some training on the VPN, how to access the network remotely and things like that. So, do you want to tell them a little bit about what you look for in a quote? And I haven't given them the numbers yet.
Okay. So. Well, I was looking for a very specific laptop line from Dell so I could compare apples to apples between the two businesses in town and Dell. So I gave a quote to spec to Morse Electronics and MoBiz. For Morse Electronics, I got an exact quote back for $1,452.55. From MoBiz, I got an exact quote back of $1,275. And from Dell Online, I got it for $1,223.41. The difference between them is with Dell, within 20 minutes of being authorized to purchase a laptop, I can configure it exactly how I need to, I can order it, and it's going to be built and shipped out to me immediately. When I utilize other vendors locally, I have to wait for a quote to get back, I have to tweak it with them, and the time is just a lot longer. Dell, it's a better price because we can leverage the state premier account. And I like the ability to configure it exactly how I want to.
And you can't do that with the local providers?
I can, but time. It takes a lot longer with the local guys. Because with Dell, I can go to the website, click, 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 done.
Although we've been without them for a long time, so I don't think it's a matter of...
It's not a matter necessarily for you guys in this scenario, but when you look at the computers countywide, the one thing about getting Dell and Dell only, or choosing an option like that, is uniformity, and if Charlie needs parts and things like that, that does help too.
It's a single point of contact. That way I can control, say I buy a laptop, today, I don't want to buy a laptop that's almost exactly similar in specs next year. With Dell, I have the ability to do that. With some of the other vendors in town, they don't go directly through Dell. They go through other resellers. And they are limited by what the resellers have on inventory. And with Dell, I can leverage the state premier account, meaning I get the same purchasing benefits as the entire state. Anybody in the state of Minnesota, whether they're local or county or state, they get a set price based on the purchasing of the state.
I guess, you know, the first question, the other thing too, we quoted laptops versus tablets because of some of the security issues with tablets, specifically the VPN and, you know, and the functionality of the laptop. So I guess that's one question is, do you want them and do you want laptops? Are you okay with that? And the second question is, you know, where to make the purchase. I really would like to look at doing, you know, Charlie and I have talked about this, but countywide doing one type of computer because it's a lot easier. Parts replacement for warranties are all similar. You know, a lot of the state agencies use Dell, for instance, and they mm-hmm. do that because of some of the warranty issues and stuff on those machines. So.
Yeah, up until now we've been primarily a Lenovo company, but I can't configure stuff from a Lenovo the way I want. I'm dependent on what the resellers have in stock. So one of the reasons I went to Dell is I could build them exactly how I want and not have to worry about, oh, do they have the thin client with the SSD? You know, with Dell, I go, I want this and that.
What's the price with Dell again?
Straight from Dell is $1,223.41. MoBiz is $1,275 even. And Morse Electronics is $1,452.55.
That's just for five?
That's per laptop.
Per laptop.
Yeah.
$1,200.
Yeah.
I don't have an issue with how you want to acquire them. That's as far as I'm concerned, that's your end of the deal, and you need to do the best you can do, and I don't think the board should fight you on that as far as...
And I'm looking at cost savings.
The question I have is, what protection is the county going to afford anyone who becomes the victim of a hack, because I'm speaking from experience, I've currently been hacked, and I think Ron has too, but we are now authorized to go online and sign up for 18 months. The government's going to provide us 18 months of security because we've been hacked.
I guess I take
issue with the fact that we think this is more secure now. I just firmly believe that if a person's going to hack, they're going to hack a group rather than an individual. So,
well, as far as security or being hacked, one of the things that we have is we have network security in our network. Our email servers are protected. We have two firewalls. We have a state router that controls access coming in. When you have the laptops, you would connect to your home Wi-Fi, which would then do what's called a VPN. It's called a virtual private network. It's an encrypted tunnel that bypasses everything, goes over your public internet to our network. And that connection is secure because it's encrypted with 128-bit encryption. So what it does is it allows you to act like you're sitting here. All of our computers here are protected by antivirus. We have a good antivirus program, GFI Viper. The other aspect of it, as far as data security, you guys will oftentimes get emails that contains privileged or confidential information. If these emails go to your private email account, I can't control that server. I can't protect that server. So if that server, if that ISP gets hacked, that data is then out in the wild. So having it stored here on our servers, my network, my antivirus can help protect that.
And for data recovery, we're required to log all emails that go to you guys in case there's a data request. We need to be able to retrieve that data.
Yeah, by state law, I have to have copies of all incoming and outgoing emails for 7 years. That's a lot. That's a big server right there.
Yeah. I mean, think about just the quantity that go out on a daily basis.
Mm-hmm. I hope I explained that. Do you guys have any questions? Or
for every minute you spend trying to protect us, somebody's spending just as much time trying to hack us.
Actually, probably double that. They double it trying to hack us. Yeah.
So, still brings up my original point. What protection do we have?
Well, the only thing that's going to be on that laptop is common business.
Mm-hmm. So. And we can set it up so the laptop is encrypted. So even if somebody steals a laptop, if they don't know, and this would require two passwords, I know a little bit more of a pain, but I'm going to have to do this on other laptops here. If they don't know the first password, they can't get to the data. Even if they take the hard drive out of the laptop and put it to another machine, they couldn't access that data unless they knew that first password. So that's another level of security. It's quite similar to what I have you do with the phones. You know, the PIN and then the encryption. I'm paranoid. You know, I really am. That's my big concern is security. I always have been very security conscious. Sometimes security is a little bit more of an annoyance, but it's worthwhile.
More discussion?
I personally would like to use a local vendor.
Me too.
I understand.
We did a lot in this board. This isn't the first time we've come up with this idea of using a local vendor. Yeah. We've done it a lot.
I realize that's probably a good idea, but in this case, I think we need to defer to Charlie. He's the one that's going to set them up. He's the one that's going to maintain them. He's the one that's going to take care of them. By forcing him to go local over his preference to go direct, to me, we're micromanaging his job.
We want to pick up that way.
I think we want the lowest quote on the lowest quote here is Dell. I mean, I agree with Phil. I would really rather see Charlie control this. This is a issue that kind of goes beyond the local vendors because it ties into security and how he sets up the whole system, and it's a long-term issue.
Did we ever figure out if the Shure Technology was going to purchase these?
We
have to discuss it.
We didn't end up discussing because we had some other things and ran out of time. We could take it out of there, we could take it out of reserves, we could budget it for 2016. We have a balance of like 27,000 in that one. I think we have 54 in the other. The only thing I would say is Virginia's got a major project coming up with document imaging that might run anywhere from $50,000 to $100,000 over the next 5 years. I mean, we could maybe do like part of it this year and then stagger it for the next 5 years. And the revenue is really slowed down in that fund. So we could take, I mean, it'd be what, $6,000? Am I doing the math right?
65.
Yeah. So we could take it out of there. We could take half out of there and half out of reserves, or, you know.
What do you think?
I think we should let
We authorize purchase of the laptop directly from Dell and take it out of reserves.
I'll second that.
Any further discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Those opposed, same sign. Motion passes.
Thank you, Charlie.
I'll get those ordered for you today.
And then we'll do some training too. Maybe they can either come in, you can do either a group during a work session just to work on the VPN
group or
stuff.
Individual.
Or individual, whatever you want.
Vicky,
individuals.
Yeah, Vicky and I are here all the time. So I'll have the laptops here, get them done today, shipped. Probably be here Friday or Monday. Give us a couple days to configure them, get them set up for you. And then, just come on in.
Thanks, John.
Thank you.
Okay. The next thing I wanted to update everybody on is, so this was included in your board packet, is the complaint policy that was approved at the last SCEIC board meeting. And, you know, really the concern in that group was that there was really no confidential source to take a complaint with. Like, there would be a traditional organization because they don't have the staff. You know, they have a lot of people serving dual roles, and that process really wasn't very defined. So I worked with Blaine Hill and Michael on this, and I'll just kind of hit on the highlights here. That if anybody on the board of directors or any of the organizations that, you know, pay money or have dues to it, we're asking kind of that to follow the same process. So like, if you guys have a complaint now, you have a tool to tell that constituent to use. That they submit their complaint in writing as much as possible to ensure that it's being described as reported. The board member receiving the complaint shall forward it to the board chairman, and that person will determine if it has merit. It'll go to the executive committee, and there's four people that serve on that currently. So it won't go to the full board, it'll go to that executive committee to determine if it has merit or if it needs to be investigated. Now, there was some discussion on whether it should be, you know, not accept confidential complaints, and Blaine and I both felt that you can't rule out the people who want to be confidential. You might not be able to turn around and give them a response because you don't know who it is, but it might build a case for a bigger issue. So whether it's confidential or non-confidential, they'll accept those. We prefer those in writing to that chairperson, and then it's kept separate of the actual employees of that organization until it's investigated and decided upon. If they can reserve those at the committee, resolve those at the committee level, they'll do that. Otherwise, they may be presented to the full board of directors for review for any action. At the end of the year, at the annual meeting, there'll be just a report on the number received and resolved versus unresolved. And, you know, we talked at some length about how we would anticipate answers coming back, probably in a written format to follow up with that complaint, if it's made in their name is, you know, on there. If it's a confidential one, there's really no way other than to follow up with the person that brought it forward. So, and I guess Donnie and I felt like that was a step in the right direction, and we approved that at the last board meeting. So, any questions on that one? Okay, that was an update then for the board. The next thing I wanted to talk about was
dispatch.
Yep. So I need a motion to approve hiring Rob Lucas at grade 15, step 1, $16.78 an hour for part-time dispatcher jailer.
What was the grade and step again?
It was grade 15,
step
1.
And what was his name?
Rob Lucas.
I'll make a motion to approve.
Second.
A motion and a second to approve Rob Lucas, grade 15, step one. Any further discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, same sign. Passes.
And then we have the West Central Juvenile, Regional Juvenile Contract. Isn't that right, Connie?
Yes, it is.
Okay, and do you want to update the board on that?
Yeah, right now we pay for a quarter bed, and there was some discussion. We took in Cass County about 6 months ago from North Dakota, and it raised how many bed purchases they did. They took a 6.5 bed purchase, and we raised the number of beds we have. This is for juvenile detention though. And what it did by taking them on is help keep our costs down, but now it's loaded up the beds because they're filling their beds. And Stevens County in the past has went years without using the bed purchase. The bed purchase is right around roughly $20,000 for our quarter bed a year. There was some discussion right at the beginning of the meeting. We've had, just take this year for instance, we've had someone in detention down there pretty much the whole year, and we purchased 90 days worth of beds for our quarter bed. And we've had someone in there 181 days, I believe. So we've used up, and what happened in the past, when we have someone in there and they're using the bed, the first 90 days we paid for, and after that, as long as there was beds open, we didn't pay anything. So we've got almost double our bed purchase for the one price. And now with Cass County being entered in there, the beds, they're guaranteeing us our quarter bed, but right now, it's gonna get slimmer and slimmer to get anything other than that in there. And right now, if we do get someone in, it'll continue to be paid for free above the 90 days. But I think what's gonna end up coming down the road, it isn't now, because they are, but I think they're gonna ask for a per diem for any extra over the 90 days. But right now, for this year, because we had the discussion there, they're not gonna raise it. And if they do a per diem, it'll probably be in 2016. So we'll have to look at it then, because it'll make a difference in the sheriff's budget, or I don't know, we're gonna look up who actually pays, because some of that is treatment time. If someone gets sent to the Pathways program down there, that actually eats up our 90 days, and that could be sent there from other than the courts.
Correct. And I talked to both Joni and Jason, and neither one of them felt like we should purchase any additional time right now. They just said it's been too unpredictable over our history that some years we'll go without using it and others we will. And they didn't feel like we should reach out to any other entities to purchase any bedtime because we just don't have the statistics to prove that right now. So they figured being in, let's see how 16 goes and then assess that going into the 17 budget cycle.
The one point that they made was that the judicial system in the courts, a lot of the judges have changed in the last couple of years, and the way that they handle juvenile prisoners, they're not sending them home, they're sending them to detention.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what's driving, that's one of the driving forces to the bed population going up.
And tying back into some of the mental health issues that
yes.
Joni talked about this morning is that the severity and frequency is so much higher, so instead of sending them home, they're putting them in shelter care or the detention care with the complement of the mental health services.
There aren't many mental health beds available anymore.
No,
they're
no.
Down.
Jason's, you know, the next closest is Wilmer,
yeah.
And you know, he said better to buy the quarter of a bed and pay the per diem if it comes to that, because we've had good luck with that facility.
Yeah.
Don't they reevaluate that every 3 years anyway, and it goes on usage? That's how they come up with the quarter bed first?
No, we've just purchased a quarter bed at the price, and our, the price for bed has not changed since I've been on the board. So,
but I thought that's how they originally came up with that quarter bed, was they looked at our usage.
Well, we decided that.
Okay.
There's some that purchase an eighth of a bed.
Mm-hmm.
But I feel, just from sitting through their meetings now, that we're not a very big player in that game up there, and now there's more and more. I think that we might get
pushed out.
Well, I don't know if they can't push us out because we're
yeah.
part of it, but I think it's going to be harder and harder to maintain a quarter of bed if we had, like when we had the murder in Alberta, that almost 2 years worth of beds got used up, and we didn't pay anything extra out of that time. And they're not, we're not going to be able to get that service no more because of the bed usage. So just wanted to be aware, there might be something coming down in the future.
So we have to approve the contract though?
Yes, we have to approve it.
The contract is for the 2016 year in the amount of $19,875 for the quarter bed.
Move to approve.
Second. Got a motion and a second to approve that contract. Any further discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, same sign. Motion passes.
And the last thing, I just wanted to give you an update. Budgets are due to me by the end of the day on July 31st. And then we'll have our first work session on August 11th to review those. I'll take the time in between to meet with them individually and go over it. I just wanted to ask you all, because I couldn't find the history on it, but I was going to send out a list to the programs that we give appropriations to historically. And I, you know, the one was pretty easy. It's Soil and Water, Regional Library, Ag Society, SCIC, and Historical Society. That was requesting their amount by the middle of August, the 18th, because that's, I think, when our second work session is.
Is the Fair Board in there?
Yep, I have Ag Society, yep.
Oh, Ag Society.
Yep, and then do we send ones to some of our other entities beyond that? You know, West Central, we've got that now. Janet had on here Minnesota River Basin, Red River Basin, Land of the Dancing Sky.
Minnesota River Basin doesn't exist.
No, that's
not. Okay, she, this is a list she gave me, so, but do we give to any other entities like that that need a letter, or is it just those main ones, do you think? Getting everybody captured. Otherwise, if you guys give to things like this, it's coming through committee reports, I hope. So, okay. And other than that, I mean, like I said, I've gotten four back already. They've been pretty responsive and coming in quick. But, you know, it's the driving factor is always his wages. So, you know, we have those who have steps coming. That certainly drives payroll, and that's the biggest increase. People have been pretty judicious in their requests for increase for any other areas. Actually, there's some reduction in costs for office supplies and things like that. So that's all I have on that for right now.
And that's it? Commissioner's report?
I have one. We had the Viking Region Library 40th anniversary last Friday, and I was not aware that the state was pushing for incorporation, and there were some local folks that got together that really wanted it to be federated, and the difference would be to have more local control. And so some of those founding members were there on Friday as well. So it's a good service that we provide to our residents, and the bookmobile on the back has got like 400,000 miles on it, 437,000 miles on it. And but they go to group homes, they go to daycares, they go to jail facilities, and it's a good service that we provide.
I don't know.
I just need to add a work session to the public meetings for August 11th at 8 a.m. And that is to do the first pass of the budget. I believe I have, I'll distribute that preliminary packet in advance so you can
sure.
Review it. But I believe that day we could schedule, I'll have department heads available if you have specific questions for different areas.
So I have it at 1 o'clock. Is it at 8 o'clock or 1 o'clock?
I put it at 1. Can we do 8 o'clock instead?
Sure.
Just 1 o'clock?
Better for you? Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I wonder why we don't have a meeting that day.
No.
I don't know. I have both times in here. Okay.
And then we'll be getting another special session when you get a hold of healthcare people.
Yes, and maybe we can tie in that same day. I have 8 to 11 blocked off. I don't anticipate probably needing that. Maybe we can,
that might work.
It'll be a full day, but we can maybe limit them or, you know, help you guys a little bit and schedule those condensed.
Yeah.
Because that'll certainly impact those discussions. So 8 a.m. on the 11th.
Any else?
Promotion to adjourn.
Motion to second adjourn, all in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Meeting adjourned.